Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text this morning is both of the lessons which you heard just a moment ago, James chapter 2, verses 14 through 26, and Romans chapter 4, verses 1 through 8. Dear Christian brothers and sisters, Jesus, I know, and Paul, I know, but who are you, James? Now that's not a bad question just on the face of it, because the James who wrote our first lesson today is not the James that usually comes to mind first for us, right? Peter and Andrew, James and John, right? The original 12 disciples, James being one of those, right? He, however, was already dead, killed by Herod by the time our first lesson was written. And then two, this question of who this guy James is a lot more complicated than that. Obviously, it is complicated by the fact that James seems to come along, thank you very much, and contradict everything that St. Paul has been teaching us about justification by faith apart from the works of the law. Did you notice that in hearing the two lessons read just a second ago? Right? As Lutherans, we all know very well what St. Paul teaches us about justification by grace through faith apart from the deeds of the law. As, for example, in our second lesson today from Romans chapter 4, where Paul says, if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God and was counted to him as righteousness. His faith is counted as righteousness. And you know, just a few verses before our second reading, back in Romans chapter 3, for we hold that one is justified by faith apart from the deeds of the law. We all know that. We Lutherans stand on that, don't we? But then, along comes James. And he says, was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. That's James. And James, who are you to come off saying something like that? Luther, at one point, said that this James couldn't possibly be an apostle because no apostle would ever say that. So then, we might ask ourselves, this James, is he an apostle? Which really means, is he writing this by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit? If he's coming along and contradicting all those things we hold so dear by St. Paul. Except that there is a different scenario. A much, much better scenario. It begins like this. St. Paul didn't write, for example, the book of Romans, and then James come along and contradict Paul, right? In fact, it's very likely, probably true, that James wrote first before St. Paul. Very likely, James was the very first book of the New Testament to be written. And then later, Paul comes along and writes Romans and Galatians and all the rest. And this James was very likely the half-brother of Jesus, right? That is a son of Mary and Joseph after Jesus was born. So then, we have a very different kind of sequencing to begin with. But who really cares? I mean, does that really make any difference at all? Well, maybe it makes a very, very big difference, as a matter of fact. Because, see, this James, that half-brother of Jesus, was the head of the church in Jerusalem. Which means he was highly respected by all the apostles. It was this James who, at the first church council, okay, the Jerusalem Council of 49 AD, it was this James, the head of that local church, who stood up and said, Paul and Peter are right that we mustn't require a work, that is specifically circumcision, of new believers. And when this James stood up and spoke, end of the conversation. Everybody in the council, Paul and Peter and all the apostles, said, well, James said it. That's it. Obviously, this James had a huge level of respect. And the conversation at that Jerusalem council was specifically that we are cleansed by faith, apart from any works. This James was also the guy to whom Jesus gave a very special individual resurrection appearance, mentioned by St. Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. This Paul, or rather this Peter, this James, this half-brother of Jesus, then, is a guy who, although he didn't believe at first, was one who had absolutely up close and personal first-hand knowledge of everything that Jesus said, did, and taught. So then, this James doesn't come along and contradict what St. Paul wrote. On the contrary, this James laid down the first word, the word closest to Jesus Christ himself, which meant then that James is writing assuming that all of us know everything exactly as Jesus himself did it and taught it. James is assuming that we know there's no way that we could be justified by our works. Of course not. How can anyone offer to God his works when he has Jesus? When someone has seen and heard and intimately known Jesus, when Jesus has given himself to us, how could we possibly offer something to God when Jesus has become the sacrifice for us? How could we possibly think we could add any kind of sacrifice to that? When we know that Jesus has said, it is finished, how could someone knowing that possibly think there's something more to do? James knew, of course, we can't be justified by what we do. James assumed we all knew that. And so instead, James figures that he's safe in describing, talking about, the way faith works. Verse 18, he says, I will show you my faith by my works.
have been saved by Jesus' death on the cross.
Could your faith see a poor person and just say, oh, be warmed, be filled, not give him something? Of course not! You who have faith, who know that you have been saved by Jesus' cross, could your faith see a poor kid in school who doesn't have any friends and just feel sorry for him? Not invite him to join you for lunch?
Of course not!
You who have faith, who know that you have been saved by Jesus' death on the cross. When kids attack you, criticize your faith, make fun of you, could your faith not say, here I stand, and I want you to stand here with me? Of course not! You know you've got it going on. You know you have eternal life in heaven, and you know how those poor kids are missing out. Of course your faith is going to say, yes, Jesus is my Savior and yours. And I want you to stand here with me on that same magnificent salvation. That's the way faith works. That's just the way faith works. And that's what James is talking about. It's also what Jesus means. Jesus, who did everything for your salvation, who did the only work that mattered when he went to the cross, who has given you eternal life in heaven. It's what Jesus meant when he said, inherit the kingdom prepared for you, for you fed and clothed and visited the least of these, my brothers. That's Jesus. And that's James.
Here's something you might be shocked to hear at Higher Things. Dare to be Lutheran, here I stand, right? That is, St. Paul really only comes along and writes about justification because all of us so often misunderstand what James assumed and what Jesus
like all those times when we do all those kinds of things that aren't the way faith works. And we need to hear God through St. Paul tell us, you are justified, you are forgiven, free gift by Jesus' death and resurrection.
So, thank God we know James and Paul,
because both of them help us to know all we really need to know. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus.